Eli has grown so big, hey?
Hello, hello.
Yeah.
It's a big deal. Oh, what are you having a party or sleepover? What, guys? Hi, Janet.
Hi.
Katie, hi, George.
Hi.
Hey, guys.
Hi.
Oh, Mr. Hool in the house. Come on.
Say.
Welcome.
Sorry, I woke up a bit late, so I haven't had a shower. excuse the.
Love the day, Andrew. All good, all good.
Thanks. Hey, yo, you guys are a party.
Yeah.
Nice. Is Gerald off in another room somewhere?
Yeah, yeah.
He's been banished from the couch.
I have. Photos, welcome. Who else has popped on? I see Wandile. Welcome, Wandile. Welcome.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, everyone.
Hi. Nice to have you.
Hi.
Hey.
All right, I think we'll make a start in 2 minutes. So say your hellos. Keep saying your hello. Nice to see everyone. A little bit.
Yeah. You can say hello.
Caleb, come on, boy.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, Kristen.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, Caleb.
Hello.
Hello, Caleb.
You guys want to say hello?
Your baby.
Hello. Baby. My baby. Hello, toy baby.
Hello, Roz. Welcome, Roz.
Yes, Sandile.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
We saw your message, Sandile. We're working on it.
Okay. Okay. Sure. Yeah. Nice to see a few faces this morning. Great. Great to be together this morning. Who else has popped on? No one new in the last bit, but yeah, it's good to see people. Rhoda's on the couch there. How are you going? What have you got to say, Miguel?
It's been a good start to the season. And if anyone wants to join fantasy football, let me know if you think you know who the good players are.
This is the Premier League, for those who might not know.
Well, everyone knows. I mean, who wasn't watching yesterday? I don't
know. But Arsenal. You'd have to pay me to watch them.
I know, because it's just so intimidating for you. That's why you come to church on Sunday, for your faith.
Oh, shots fired. Shots
Which is your team then?
Oh, the great team. Manchester United Football Club.
Okay.
With the greatest. How long have you been won the most trophies?
How long have you been supporting them for?
Probably since I was 8. But
oh, good. That's all right then.
Ferguson was in primary school.
Come on. Come on. I see some other people have popped on as well. Good morning. Welcome, the Eliza Gangs. Nice to have you. Freddie and Kuzi.
Good morning. How's it? Kuzi, come on. Okay, well, come on.
Michael John, welcome, welcome. Alrighty, yeah, I think we're going to make a start. So I'm going to ask you to maybe just mute yourselves and you can turn off your video. Welcome to Lita. I saw you pop on the couch there, but welcome to you too. Yeah, it's nice to be together on this colder day. We thought spring had sprung, it had, and then we got some more rain, and we're thankful for that. To think that, you know, 2 years ago we were thinking about day zero, and now the dams are full. Praise the Lord. I see a lot of them are spilling over, and so we can be really thankful for that. God waters and provides. We're going to make a start this morning. I've asked Janet to open in prayer for us and Katie to read. She's going to read Psalm 19. So if you have a Bible, you can turn to Psalm 19, and Katie's going to read for us. I'll give you a moment to turn there if you have a Bible.
Good morning, message. We're reading from the NIV version. Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens, he has pitched a tent for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming forth from his pavilion, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is hidden from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb. By them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Who can discern his errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then will I be blameless, innocent of great transgression. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Loving Father, we give you great thanks for your word. Thank you, Lord, for the reminder in this psalm of the splendor of your creation. Thank you for the blessing it is to each one of us as we experience its magnificence day by day. Thank you, Father God, for reviving our souls and giving joy to our hearts. Forgive our hidden faults and keep us from willful sins, we pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Katie and Janet. Great psalm. We're gonna sing our first song, which is a children's song, so I'll give you a moment to make some space if you need. We're gonna sing My God Is So Big, sing Hosanna. So that'll be the first song we'll sing together.
So big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. He made the trees, he made the seas, he made the elephants too. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. So big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty, there's nothing my God cannot do. The mountains are his, the rivers are his, the stars are his handiwork too. My God is so big, so strong, and so mighty.
Let's pray. Father, indeed, thank you that the grave could not hold Jesus, that he is the light of the world that burst forth from the grave, and that indeed he did rise in victory. And for those of us who have placed our faith and our trust in King Jesus, we can know that our sins are forgiven, and we can know that sin's curse has lost its grip on us. We can sing that with confidence. We can know that we're sons and daughters of the King because we've been bought by the precious blood of Jesus. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for that. We thank you for that reality. That's what we celebrate this morning together as we link arms in this virtual way. But, Lord, we also know that we struggle with sin as we await the full coming kingdom of Jesus. And so we still wrestle with the sins of the flesh, with the lust of our eyes. And so, Lord, this morning we want to confess our sins as your word encourages us to keep short accounts with you. And so we want to sing. We want to sing this song together. Father, we want to say we're sorry. Forgive us for our sins. So let's sing this song of confession together. Indeed, Father, that is our prayer, that you would forgive us as a community, Your word says in Psalm 103, the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions for us. Thank you, Father, that those words are true, that indeed you have removed our transgressions from us, that the work of your Son, who we place our trust in this morning as a community, Jesus has done this for us. Thank you that we can celebrate the gospel afresh, the truths of the gospel, what Jesus has done. May we never get tired of it. May we continue to forgive and keep short accounts with you, Father. And we're thankful that, as the psalm says, you don't treat us as our sins deserve. Thank you that you are a loving and indeed a truly and holy and gracious Father. And so we praise you for that this morning. Amen. We're going to continue worshiping and praying to God. And I've asked Emmanuel and Michael to lead us in a time of prayer. Emmanuel will go first, so over to them, please. Let's continue to worship God in prayer.
Thank you. Let's pray. Baba, mdali wezulu nomhlaba. Siyakhothama kuwe Nkosi. Siyazi sizizoni phambi kobuso bakho. Siyacela Nkosi ukuthi usithethelele kukho konke okube sikwenzile. Siyazi futhi ukuthi uNkulunkulu nofefe uzosixolela usinike umsebenzi okumele siwenze ngendlela ofuna ukuthi wenziwe ngayo. Father, we have sinned from thousands of years ago up until now. Still, we are trying to become great and making an increasingly larger mess of your creation and ourselves. Lord Most High, through our telescopes and microscopes, your awesomeness and your greatness shows. And even more startlingly is that despite our rebellion, our now innate desire to love ourselves and inflate ourselves with feeble and fake greatness, you love us. You love everybody, those who know you and those who don't. Even we who know you struggle to really, really believe that. We become suspicious that you don't love us when things don't go our way. But you do love us because you say so. Father, you have followed up your word with proof in action. True greatness in Jesus Christ that does not mind stooping down and becoming small. You who are really awesomely great became like us in every way. Yes, Lord, in every way. And you did it so that we could become like you in every way. Thank you, Lord, that you want to fill us with your Spirit and make us alive. Those who are but dust and dead in our pride and shame. For this reason, Lord Jesus, you became like us in every way in order that you may become our merciful and faithful high priest in your service to God, and that you may make an atonement for us. We thank you, Lord. And because you did that and are now again seated at the right hand of the Father, your Holy Spirit can fill us with exactly what we need to be forgiven, to have an identity, to be yours, and to be loved by you. Oh Lord Jesus, because you have suffered when you were tempted, you are able to help us who are being tempted. Lord, if only we would desire the greatness we were created for, a relationship with you. Please forgive our perversity, our addiction to ourselves. Help us, Lord Jesus, to become addicted to you and to find our greatness in you. For this is the real greatness we were created for. Being swept up in you will allow us to live in true humility like yours, self-forgetful and other-centered. You, O Lord, are the true greatness who has made this possible by becoming like us, born of a woman and dying for us and becoming our faithful and merciful high priest. Sacrifice yourself once for all for our sake. How amazing, O Lord God, that this was always in your heart. From the time you got everything going to accept the once for all offering for your son as an atonement for our depravity. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you did not consider greatness something to be held to, but you humbled yourself for our sake. You who is rich became poor so that we who are poor can become rich and lead us to the glory and the greatness that we were created for. May we live our lives with the passion and the desire to please you always for your name and for your glory. Amen.
Amen.
Join with me in prayer. Lord Jesus, we look at our world around us today during this pandemic, and we do see so much need. We see those who are sick, those who are poor and needy, and those who are struggling and down because of the situation they find themselves. We pray for comfort and protection from them to them. We pray especially that those who are needy might find comfort in the arms of your people. We pray that the church and the Christian community would be generous and reach out. We are truly amazed by the power of a Christian community at this time, where those who are part of the community are not simply cut adrift and are not alone. Lord, we pray for, especially for those who are not exposed to this need, that they might support places that are, and that we who see the need might not just turn people away, but might be generous and ensure demonstrate the love of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your grace and mercy at this time. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love. We pray for those who are sick, especially if they're alone. We pray for your comfort on them. And we pray for those who are really struggling at this time because of the extra pressure. We pray for a burden shared, that they might be able to share their burdens and so get the comfort and support that they need, Lord Jesus. Lord God, we really cry out to you for comfort and deliverance during this really challenging time in our world and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Amir. And thank you, Buma. Thanks for praying for us. Yeah, it's great to be together again. Just a few notices. We're going back to 1 Corinthians. So we preached through 8 to 10. And now we're going back to do 6 and 7 over the next 2 weeks. Paul is away on a bit of a break. So Sans and I will pick that up on 6 and 7 over the next 2-3 weeks. Yeah, so let's keep doing that. I'm going to read the passage now. Just to say, yeah, keep the Van Wyk family in your prayers as they are expecting in the next 2 weeks, Lord willing. And the Kutsia family, as they pick up the little one this week, you can keep them in your prayers. If you be inclined, let me encourage you to drop them a sanitized, not a sanitized meal, drop them a meal or some nappies or whatever it may be. I don't know if they've had any baby showers in this time, but yeah, let me encourage you to do that. I know there are two other couples expecting the Rodos. I won't mention the next couple. I don't know if their news is public, but yeah, let me encourage you to pray for those pregnancies and to think of them in the next coming weeks. I'll drop them some love this week. It'd be great. So we're gonna read 1 Corinthians, and then Sans is gonna preach to us. So if you have a Bible, you can open your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I'm gonna read out of the ESV, but you can follow along. I don't have the text up, but you can turn there. So 1 Corinthians chapter 6. We're going to look at verses 1 to 11 this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. When one of you has a grievance against another, does he dare go to the law before the unrighteous instead of the saints? Or do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if the world is to be judged by you, are you incompetent to try trivial cases? Do you not know that we are to judge angels? How much more then matters pertaining to this life? So if you have such cases, why do you lay them before those who have no standing in the church? I say this to your shame. Can it be that there is no one among you wise enough to settle a dispute among the brothers? But brother goes to the law against brother, and that before unbelievers. To the lawsuits at all with one another is already a defeat for you. Why not rather suffer wrong? Why not rather be defrauded? But you yourselves wrong and defraud even your own brothers? Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revelers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. Amen. Here ends the reading. Sands, over to you.
Morning, church. Just getting sorted here so that everything is clear. So we are continuing in our series from 1 Corinthians, as Gerard has told us. And this morning we are looking at those verses. I found this quote quite helpful and encouraging for us to just reflect on, even as we go through the verses. A judicial system is corrupt if truth is denied the right to be a witness. A judicial system is corrupt if truth is denied the right to be a witness. How do Christians handle disputes? How should Christians handle disputes? More personally, how do you, when you have issues, difference of opinion with another fellow human being who calls himself a Christian, how do you go about the business of seeking and getting justice. We would not be followers of the Lord Jesus Christ to think that our words and actions do not matter. Because as those who are disciples of Jesus, our lives are on constant public display to the watching and waiting world. When the world watches and hears how we respond and how we relate to one another, they either get a taste of Christianity that is attractive, or they get a taste of Christianity that is repelling. And the reality is that for all of us, sons and daughters of Adam and Eve, disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, that our lives come filled with all manners of vices. Even as Vuma was praying, those truths, that reality of how we are so filled with ourselves and how we want to live lives that are focused on me, become very apparent even in such matters as dealing with differences and disputes. And usually this ends up hurting one another, ends up discrediting the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and shaming the Christian name and faith. If you just think for a moment of how many churches that you personally know or know people in churches that have split because of disputes, because of differences, how should Christians deal with disputes? See, despite the glorious opening verses of our letter, 1 Corinthians, the first 9 verses that tell us who these Corinthians are before God Almighty, chosen and set apart and His, page after page tells us that the Corinthian church, the Corinthian believers, were a bunch of people who didn't live out their true identity to be who God had called them to be. In this first half of our chapter, which will continue even next week, we see how they were taking each other to court. They were appealing to ungodly means and solutions to solve out internal and personal community problems. And so Paul, for us, in this passage, in these first 11 verses, outlines two very clear points. The first 6 verses, he wants us to know that Christians should settle their own disputes and not appeal to outside ungodly solutions. Then the second part of the section shows us where Paul is saying seeking ungodly solutions to disputes discredits and dishonors Christ, and it gives Christianity a bad name. Let me paint to you just a small context of how life was like in Corinth, how the judicial systems were done in those times. See, ancient Roman courts did their systems in such a way that there was nothing else that could be relied upon to administer justice impartially, since the judicial systems were so open to bribes and corruption that they were partial to the status and power of the prosecutor or the defendant or both. Justice was always going to be for the one who had the deepest pockets, the one with which to tip the scales of justice in their favor. That's how it went. The judicial system, one commentator says, was damaged by improper influence that made equality before the law unattainable. But we know, as we read God's word, that these types of court hearings, as we read and understand the Corinthian culture and context, that these types of hearings had become more than just about money. They had become more than just about breaking your bank balance. They often got personal. And as they did that, they sought to shame, dishonor, and destroy reputations. Another commentator says the proceedings were not conducted dispassionately by the parties, but with great acrimony. That means simply bitterness or ill feeling. Advocates were not expected to show any restraint, but were permitted to use the most unbridled language about their clients' adversaries, or even their friends, relations, or witnesses. Those who practice the trade labored hard to develop the character assassination skills. They knew how to shut you down by just how they spoke. They would often play to the crowds of onlookers as they did whatever it took to get paid. And when this was a regular kind of thing in Corinth, which it seems in Paul's writing, it becomes something that crept in to the church. And as it did so, it was causing much heartache, so to the point that the apostle is greatly appalled at what he sees happening. In each and every chapter that we read about life in Corinth for these believers, is something very little to be desired. We must understand, therefore, though, that Paul is not saying that disputes should not be a thing in the lives of believers. Of course, we are sinners and we are fallible. And so difference of opinions is something that is quite unavoidable. But we do get a great guideline on how disputes should be handled. Even from Jesus himself in Matthew 18, when if someone, you talk to them, you show them their fault, and if they will not listen, you take it to others, you take it to witnesses. If they will not listen to that, you take it to the leaders. And only then, as the final result, do you take it outside the church, the community. So the Corinthian practice, as Paul writes in chapter 6, in every single way was going against the very words and rules and guides of what God had said to them. Even the very, very words of Moses in Deuteronomy that set up how matters should be handled, this they went against. For Deuteronomy 16 tells us, appoint judges and officials for each of your tribes in every town that God is giving you, and they shall judge the people justly. Do not pervert justice or show partiality. Do not accept a bribe, for a bribe blinds the eyes of the wise and twists the words of the righteous. Follow justice justly. Deuteronomy 16, 18 to 20. As we observe the text before us, we see in every way that this was not how the Corinthians conducted themselves. We see that common practice in Corinth left very little to be desired. Paul says, if you have disputes about such matters, and you have lawsuits among you, and you yourselves cheat and do wrong, and you do this to your brothers, that is not good, what's happening at Corinth. Let me give you two stories to illustrate the relevancy and the currentness of the situation in Corinth, even in today living. You know, before COVID-19 made us rethink many things on how to do life, on how to preach, now we're speaking to screens and we're hoping that you're nodding your heads and that you're hearing what God is saying. But before these days came to us, I used to enjoy going to the pub to work out my sermons, because I knew that most often I would be guaranteed a live illustration. And now that the social distancing rules have been lowered a little bit, I got back to Hobnobs. And on Friday, I had probably my second live illustration of such things. I started getting out my laptop, my Bible, my commentaries, putting it there on the desk, and then starting to write and think. And then these two gentlemen approach, they're playing some pool, I'm watching while I'm thinking and writing and reflecting, and the conversation begins. This fellow by the name of Nicholas comes to me and says, what are you working on? And I say, well, I'm working on a sermon I'm going to preach on Sunday, which is what I'm delivering to you. He says, what is it about? Well, it's from 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Do you know it? No, what does it say? It's about Christians taking each other to court over lawsuits when they should, in fact, deal internally with these problems as a family of God's people. Immediately, Nicholas, that is, tells me of his recent incident about his ex-landlord that not wanting to pay him back and wanting to take the matter to big courts instead of just settling the issue. But as I had these conversations with Nicholas, it dawned on me how current the Corinthian situation is in everyday living. The fascinating thing about my conversation, of course, with Nicholas was that despite his recent misfortunes, and he had quite a few, he wore a smile on his face, a smile that warmed my heart. Now, I'll tell you a little bit more about Nicholas later, but let me get closer to home with this illustration of disputes. I remember it as if it happened yesterday. It must have been now 4 years ago. I was leading a service at the Message, and there amongst those gathered was someone who had been deeply hurt by what I had done. And even though I didn't know this at the time, but for them it became a great struggle to become part of this local church, where someone standing up front there was saying things that didn't actually hold true to who they were in character, or at least in part. And for them, it had become a struggle, should they become part of this community when this is happening? And so after the service that day, they asked to speak to me. We sat down, we got to know each other a little bit, and then they told me their grievance. They told me how they'd been hurt by something I wasn't quite aware of. I'm very glad for the conversation, even as I think and share it today. I'm glad because for me, that was one clear way that Paul says matters of this nature should be handled. I was able to see the error of my ways, and I did the best I could to apologize and ensure that true confession because I'd been shown that error. But the Corinthians? Not at all. They'd rather take each other to court and sue each other and make those who don't have money live, just kept on bribing and paying the systems to get verdicts their way. This is not how Christians should live. But these two stories that I've just told you, that of Nicholas and that of myself, depict something of what should be a Christian's way of handling disputes. Not only so, but these stories tell us something of the why and how we should handle disputes. And Paul lays in on those practical ways of dealing with differences. I think we far too quickly miss out what Paul is trying to say to us and the kind of worth that is given to a Christian community so that they don't take internal problems to public ungodly spheres for solutions. I think we easily get sidetracked by verses like 2 and 3, where Paul asks the questions, do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And then in verse 3, do you not know that we will judge angels? As I did a little bit of reading and reflecting on what Paul is saying in these 11 verses, it dawned on me, it became increasingly clear that we as Christians have great worth that God has given, great honor, great dignity. And disputations handled the way that the Corinthians were doing so was really shaming and discrediting that gospel and that name. You see, as I read and reflect on what Paul is saying to the Corinthian believers, and always have the first 9 verses before you when you read every problem in Corinth, always remember who these people are before God. And as I read and reflected on what he's telling them, I remembered and I realized that Christians, says the Apostle Peter, are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a people for God's own possession. Paul, writing to Timothy, says that the church is a household of God, a pillar and buttress of truth. That word buttress just simply means we are that pillar stone, that concrete beginning piece that from where the rest of the structure is upheld. That's who the church is supposed to be. That is why when people look inside from the outside, they're supposed to be attracted to how we speak, to how we act. There's great worth, great dignity in who God has made his people to be. Psalm 8 tells us that what makes the Lord's name majestic in all the earth is what God has done for men. I've asked Mthethwa to read for us this Psalm 8. And as it does so, I want us to just listen, reflect, think on this great thing that the Lord God has done for his people and their worth and dignity, so that we can understand why Paul is so appalled at what the Corinthians are doing. Tantra.
Cool. Psalm 8, a psalm of David. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with the glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the path of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Thank you, brother. I wonder if you see the honor given to man in this psalm. I wonder if you understand deeply and truly who God has made you to be as a community, who you exist with when you look to your left and you look to your right. Obviously now, today, these days, you can't do that because most probably all you see is four corners of the wall. But in comparison and in the contrast of the beauty and majesty of creation, it baffles King David that God would be mindful of and care for man in the way that God does, to give him such worth and dignity. I wonder if you notice that God crowns man with glory and honor. I wonder if you notice that God makes man ruler of the works of his hands. I wonder if you saw that God puts everything under man's feet. And everything means everything. The greatest honor we have, as we understand the whole of Scripture, is the very word of God, which is the mind of God. And if we were live and I was seeing you face to face as I share these words, I would be hoping that if I asked, and who is the word of God, that all with one voice we would scream, Jesus. We have the very mind of God. So it doesn't make sense, as Paul writes to these Corinthians, that you would take matters within and seek solutions from outside, from those who don't have the mind of Christ. That you would do each other harm in such a way, that you would discredit the gospel in such a way. Peter also writes and tells us that the things that we have, the things and worth that God has given to his people, are things that even angels long to look into. It's a mystery. And so if we are given such worth and we're going to do such great things, can't we handle our own internal affairs? Do we need to go outside and appeal to ungodly systems and ways of getting justice? It's a serious rebuke. The reality is that if only the Corinthians really believed about each member of the church that they worshiped with, that there's worth, there's honor, there's dignity because of who God has made them to be, none of this would be the reality as they sought to reconcile and work together. If they really believed, then disputes would be handled differently. And so it's true for us. Today, 2020, the 13th of September, 2020, Sunday. Do we really believe who God says we are? What God says we are? Because if we did, even though there may be factions and disputes and differences in churches, they certainly would be handled a lot better, more practically, honoring the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. My understanding, my convictions is that so many churches are not born or created out of a desire to reach the lost, but rather because people no longer share a pastor's vision, or because they can't stand certain members in the church, and so they take a walk and they start another church just 5 kilometers down the road. And this just creates a very unhealthy, un-Christ-like way of living as a community. Can we take from what Paul is saying, the worth that Paul is giving, that we ought to be bigger and better than that? Let us understand that when we take each other to courts to appeal and ask for solutions, we're damaging the name of Christ. We're injuring one another. We give Christianity a bad name. There's another thing that is happening as Paul is writing to the Corinthians, and that is the question of reputation when these disputes are handled in such a way. Reputation from a twofold position. You see, reputation matters because on the one hand, it serves to protect the honor of God's name and to win those who do not yet belong to Christ. But if the Corinthians are doing as they are doing, none of those things are being held true to. Next time we are able to meet face to face, next time you think of somebody else within your gospel community, within the church message, see and understand the worth, the value, the dignity, the honor that God has placed on them, so that if ever there are differences, you may be able to understand that first in how you approach and deal with those disputes and differences. See the value, the worth that God gives to his people. Think of the minds that make up a church like the Message Church. Medical professions, engineers, advocates, honorable parents, teachers of all kinds, tech specialists, home designers, influencers in the financial, political, and entertainment centers, sports, agriculture, theological spheres. And if you feel that your particular profession is left out, let me give you just 5 seconds to say it in your heart, because that too is included in this community that God makes together. It's a serious issue on how we are to deal with differences and disputes because of who God says we are. And further on, as Paul continues in these verses, he shows why this is crucial, why thinking like this, doing like this is crucial. And as I said to you with my own examples, I really thank God that I had an experience, and I've had many experiences, of being able to be shown my error in a way that is honoring Christ, and therefore allowed to work out true reconciliation and moving forward. And I'm glad that the person who showed me the error of my ways is still part of this community. And it really rings true what the gospel is supposed to be about and what the gospel is supposed to do in our lives. It results in love and genuine fellowship. But what was happening with the Corinthians, and this is the rest of the passage, is that they were allowing their old selves to be hijacked, or the new identity in Christ was being hijacked by their old selves. And that is why Paul says this powerful line, and that is what some of you were. You know, we will not have come to truly experience the depth of God's grace and the power of his gospel if we never are confronted by the nature of our wickedness, the thoughts and desires that rule us from time to time, our feelings about others, thoughts about God, and what we think of one another and even of self. Once again, I'm very thankful for the prayers that Michael and Vuma made, because as I listened and reflected, there's a lot of reality to those prayers that touches on what Paul is speaking about. As it says, this is what some of you were, but you were changed. So Christian, here today, if you hold on to the name of Christ, know this, believe this, you are changed, you are different. There's a saying that we are more sinful than we can ever imagine. If you've never grappled with the truth and reality, let me ask you, do so. own up, acknowledge the fact that you are more sinful than you can ever imagine. This is what Paul declares of himself, writing to young Timothy, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. That ought to be a reality of us, even as we claim to believe in the Lord Jesus. So if you are here and you are listening, and you haven't grappled with that reality, that at heart you're a sinner, at heart I'm a sinner, you need to think about that. And this will help you work on your spiritual vitality and your connection and relation with who God is. But that is not where Paul leaves things. He doesn't say, and that is what some of you are. He says, and that is what some of you were. It is a past thing. This is what they used to be in the past, no longer. God has done something. This is who they used to be. And Paul begins to mention a list of things that these Corinthian believers in reality used to be. These are not things that are hard for us to relate. Perhaps, like the Corinthians, some of us were sexually immoral. And I doubt that any of us are unscathed by sexual immorality in our day and age. That if you haven't physically done those things, certainly the mind, the eyes, the heart has sinned more than times to counter sexually before God. He speaks about defrauding and thievery. I remember my very first act of theft. It was in grade 3, standard 1 back then. In the exam room, I dropped a pencil to swipe a rand. And I raced with that rand after the exam to go buy the biggest apple I'd ever seen. I took one bite at this apple and I saw that it was rotten to the core. Maybe it was God's way of just judging me there, reminding me that this is not on. Paul mentions drunkenness. I remember my first incident of drunkenness. Growing from an orphanage where that was just frowned upon. And even when I started making connections with home life, that is something I never did. I went to Bible college in KZN. And one day I'm busy having great philosophical conversations with a friend about the wisdom of Solomon, or the foolishness rather of Solomon and his 300 concubines, or porcupines as we call them. That he keeps giving me this sweet drink. And as I drink, I get more passionate in talking about Solomon. I realized after that hour or so of talking that my head was quite heavy. And as I walked, it wasn't my feet that led me home, but it was my head. But this is what some of you were. What God begins to do by his Spirit, what God had begun to do in the lives of the Corinthian church believers, is amazing. He'd given them his Spirit. He'd given them the mind of Christ. And here in this letter, he says to them, number one, you were washed. Jesus' death and resurrection paid and pays for your sins. Believe and live in this reality. He says, you were sanctified. You were and are sanctified. This means that you have been set apart for God's use as instruments of holiness. On a day-to-day basis, this daily act of repentance as an individual, as a community, means you are being set apart, means you belong to somebody else, means you are something else truly in its fullness. He says, you were and are justified. Remember the song, it's just as if you've never sinned. When God looks at those who call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, he sees the perfect finished work of the Lord Jesus. This is who we are. This is who the Corinthians are, not who they were, who they are. Therefore, learn to take personal matters and deal with them in a way that honors the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. See, that saying that says you are more sinful than you can ever imagine also goes on to say you are loved more than you can ever dream. You are forgiven. You are loved. You are accepted. That is the motivation that drives how we deal with disputes and differences. It is the love that deeply comes from knowing who Jesus is and who Jesus has made us. Washed, sanctified, justified. Back to Nicholas as I end. See, as we talk more about Nicholas, and he told me that he was a Christian, and he's this heartwarming smile that came to me as he told me of his problems and the disputes, was that he is living it in the hands of God. And Paul says, far rather it that you are wronged than wrong one another and defraud one another. This is who we are as God's people. And I pray and hope that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ will allow us to do these things, to be these things more and more. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word. We thank you that because of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are changed. We are new. We are new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. And this is the work of God by the power of the Spirit. Help us when we deal with differences and disputes and matters of different opinions to not seek outside ungodly solutions, to work things as you call us to, as your people. Help us not to wrong and defraud one another. Help us to know what you've done for us, in us, through us. You've washed us, you've sanctified us, you've justified us. Help us to live in true reality of these promises, of these realities today. We ask it in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, for his glory and our good. Amen.
Amen. Yeah, folks, thanks, Sans, for preaching. We're just going to have a time of some questions or additions or clarifications. Has anybody got any questions they want to ask Sans or add to what? Well, yeah, not to preach another sermon, but maybe to add something. So I don't know, are there any questions?
Yes. Sans, so what happens in cases where it's not just a disagreement? For example, in my background, I'm familiar with stories where this passage is abused. For example, one story that came to mind as I was hearing you preach is where maybe this passage has been used to say that in extreme cases, like, for example, domestic abuse, the church or pastors would be like, no, let's try and deal with this internally and rather than get law enforcement involved. And in one case, it got so bad that the husband beat and killed his wife because there was no law enforcement involved in the case. It was something they tried to handle internally and they failed. So is there like bounds? Where can you draw the line and be like, okay, this is where it's healthy and okay to seek the law enforcement system outside?
Now that's a great question, Caleb. Thank you. And I knew that such a question would come, and that's why I'm glad for question and answer time, because it further adds to what we're trying to teach. We need to understand that obviously there is a great difference between civil law and criminal law. And what Paul is presenting here, this case, is civil matters within the life of a church. Obviously, that situation, example that you paint, that you gave, is something that life, the very existence of another being, is in question, that does. In fact, when you read wider in the writings, not just of the Bible, but of Paul, in Romans 13, it tells you that the government is God's servant. So obviously, there are certain issues that certainly need the hand of the law to intervene. But here, the kinds of things that the Corinthians were doing were taking each other to task and appealing to ungodly solutions for things that they could handle internally. As God's people, God had invested quite a lot of worth and dignity that they could handle the problems that were going on. But you're absolutely right. I'm not saying, and Paul is not saying, that we should never seek the justice system, but we should work every case on its merits. And it's good to just know the differences between criminal and civil law.
Yeah.
Anybody can get to that, yeah.
I think you're right. You did talk about the context in which, so I think if you think of what Paul has said in 1-4 about the honor and shame culture, the way they were thinking about their leaders, the way they were boasting, there was this culture of getting upmanship on one another. And I think that's quite, I mean, Sandra, you did mention that. I think that's quite important. You know, it was also about reputation. So taking someone to court because it elevates you. And so I think that's some of the context to which they were doing. Because I think, Caleb, you're absolutely right. I mean, we've seen and heard of also the child abuse scandals in the States of cases coming out, you know, 20, 30 years later, or women coming forward to senior pastors. It seems to be in the news every 6 months of senior pastors that sexually harassed or abused someone, and you have these. And I think sometimes the danger has been is that the church has taken these verses and been like, let's try and sort out those matters ourselves without going outside. And so I think particularly with minors who can't defend themselves, I think certainly we want to go to the authorities to help adjudicate that. I think it would be unwise to think that the church could solve those issues. But I think it's the spirit of, even as we thought about the principles of 9-11 and what Paul is driving at, is trying to help the Corinthians, and the way that, you know, Paul, San spoke about, you know, the culture has come into the church. And so they're still with those values of getting up above each other, this honor and shame tussle. And so it's quite important to keep that in mind. But certainly, I think there is room, and as Sansa said, to know when it's not the scope of our practice to be able to handle such other matters. But thanks, Sansa. I think that was a good point.
Thoughts, comments, more questions? Michael, sorry, man. Your Amir, I think the video is on. And
Hi, Amir.
I'm just reading a message from Miguel here. Everyone should see this. Probably where the appropriate consequences can't be administered by the church, example jail, then you should use the legal system. But perhaps Paul would say only to do so after consultation with the church, that's the appropriate consequence. Yeah. Thanks, Miguel. I think, yeah, that's precisely so. Thanks.
Just to add to that, Miguel, I agree with Miguel, and it is obviously appropriate to seek advice and counsel from the elders in the church. I just figured that actually most churches, especially the different kinds of churches, most of them are not structured in a way that provides resources to deal with disputes. And so it seems that the closest or the most viable solution is to go straight to the outside for safety and sort of the swift justice type of thing. So I just wanted to sort of point out that we are actually lucky that we are able to discuss these things, and we have a structure that's equipped for such things. But not all the Christian churches are like that, and that's the unfortunate part.
Yeah. Thanks for that. Yeah, I think that's true. And perhaps why the call to just live missionally minded lives is perhaps you are a friend to one or two of those people who find themselves in setups where that is not common practice. And so you, with your knowledge and wisdom, are supposed to be of help in those situations where you can. Obviously, we're not trying to involve yourself at large with the life and the runnings of another local church. But I think the whole idea that there's a universal church, the local church and the universal church, means we can, as brothers and sisters, help one another as God reveals these things to us, we're supposed to help those who are in situations where it's not common practice, just by how we perhaps can give guidance. I think that the big idea that Paul is wanting the Corinthians to know is that within your community, within your context, there are people who are capable of handling these things, given the fact that we will handle bigger and greater things. That is the idea. Before you go outside there where the help and solutions is ungodly, deal with the issues in a Christ-honoring manner. All right.
Now, there aren't any more questions. I see there's something from Michael.
You can read it, G.
For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath, to bring punishment for the wrongdoer. Romans 13. Yeah, Sans alluded to that. Thanks, Michael. I'm going to read one of my favorite psalms, just the ending or the beginning of Psalm 67. And then I'm going to give you an opportunity to leave if you'd like to, but let me encourage you to join a breakout group, just to, yeah, to touch base with other people, say hello, say a prayer. It's good to do that. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us, Selah, that your way may be known on the earth, and your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let the peoples praise you. Father, thank you for this time together. Bless the rest of our days, the rest of our day. Amen.
Amen.